academic and theater, the place where they both meet.
You have the audience and your participants for each other.
Communication practices, historical practices.
Examples of women.
Sharing what it is that you do, sharing how you do that.
There's no way you can ignore that business anymore.
Work from all around the world, you can
kind of see what's going on.
This starts out with a little thing, you write a bit, you have to do it, but before it comes to
theater for everybody, yes, everybody.
That's it, what should be done?
And indeed, my understanding of life, relationships, death, have already changed.
The survival of theater as an art form depends on that.
So welcome everybody here to the Martin E. Siegel Theater Center at the Graduate Center at CUNY, and it's very, very kind and generous of you to come out on one of the first sunny days and warmer days in I think 4 or 5 months. And Aristide, hello, this is one of our pen playwrights from Burkina Faso we just had yesterday. This is the third day of this great festival. We have 10 most significant writers from all around the globe here at the Siegel Center. It's the most significant gathering of professional writers from around the world and both of the Americas, and we're very proud and honored to be the host of this festival. For over 10 years, we now collaborate with Penn World Voices, a brilliant, I think, festival of literature and art created by Paul Auster and Salman Rushdie during the very first Bush administration. They felt very strongly that there was a tunnel vision in America, that there were not enough voices heard from outside America. 95% to 96% of all books published were by British or American writers, and only the 4%, the half of it was French or German because of subsidies. And so only 1 or 2 books out of 100 offer a view that is perhaps slightly different to understand or to share moments of reality, and for good reasons. They said that something should be done, and it would be unthinkable for musicians just to listen to American music or British music. World music is a major factor. It is, of course, people do play and perform locally, but you have to know what people do in other countries, what musicians and artists do. So this is our contribution. We are extremely proud to be collaborating with this great organization. Penn, please do support it. It gets writers out of prison. It hands out one of the most significant literary awards. And they have so many writing programs, translation programs. It's one of the great organizations, I feel, and I think, too, really deserves our support. My name is Frank Henschke. I'm the director of the Siegel Center here at the Graduate Center CUNY, and we bridge academia and professional theater, international and American theater. And this festival, where we really bring in writers and offer it for free, they all come except for two here. It's a very big undertaking. It's a big effort from the entire Siegel team, who I would like to thank. But also I would like to tell you, this is really what we care about. This is at the center of our mission, and we are so happy to have you here on a Saturday afternoon. So it means really means a lot to us. All the way from Cameroon here, so is our playwright Edouard Elvis Bouma. So say hello. I think he had a long odyssey with flights changed. It was really over 20 or 25 hours for him just to get here to be with that. He came really here to hear his first time play done in English, also Aristide, who we had yesterday, right, here. So it is a great thing, I think, that we also provide writers with the possibility to spend some time here in the U.S. and see what also are realities compared to what one normally knows from books or films. So thank you so very much for coming. Thanks for Heather, a great PhD candidate here at the Graduate Center, also helped with the translations and is researching this area of theater, and came to us also with the suggestion, Emmanuel Siwa from SEAD in Canada, and also others, the French Cultural Services, who helped us, Nicole is here. So this is really a great effort and a great collaboration, and so thank you for coming. The play should not be longer than 90 minutes, even so, of course, it is much longer. like the Elfriede Jelinek plays for 5 hours, and we had to cut it down, and as the Goat's play is 3.5, so you will see in Accept we have the full script in case you are interested. Again, thank you really all for doing this, and also for Gisela to direct it, so she is the director. So thank you so much. If you have a cell phone, now is the time, just do take it out and see if it says off, unmute, so it does not ring. Just double check, please. I know it will happen. Thank you. And there will be a little discussion after the play here in the room in case you would like to say. Again, thank you all for coming. And Michael, let's go.
Edouard Elvis Mvuma, In War Has in Games, translated by Hera Jen Denier. Game over. Has after a tornado, or a hurricane, or a fiesta, a young boy, a young girl, an old transistor radio.
Game over. You heard? Like me. Game over, he said. Don't tell me you didn't hear what I just heard. What he just said? I can't replay it because the radio doesn't replay like a cassette player where you push the button with the left arrow to make the cassette go backwards. You heard, but did you understand? You know there's a difference between hearing and understanding. That's what Professor Calculus said. Not the real Professor Calculus, but Tintin's friend. That's what we called him at school, because he was the Professor Calculus. From the 1st to the 31st, he wore a khaki shirt like Professor Calculus' green jacket. He had a Professor Calculus beard and Professor Calculus glasses. You heard what he just spat into our ears, but did you understand it like I understood it? Oh, that's it. So that's why the camp is empty. Empty like the Roman camp after Astrid and the Gauls passed through when they drank the magic potion. No one left. They didn't finish the spit roast pig and all the food that they were eating yesterday to celebrate the taking of Decemberry, like the Gauls celebrated when they beat the Romans over and over again. Look, they didn't even empty the cask of red wine, which was stolen yesterday from the parish priest. Oh, the fat priests like Friar Tucker and Robin Hood, whose arm they cut off because he wouldn't let go of the casket of communion wine. Yeah, I've heard nothing but because of the Jemma Jemma and the whiskey. Nope. I've heard nothing because of the Jamma Jamma and the whiskey. Did you hear anything? Did they flee or are they dead? Tell me. Are they dead or did they flee? What the heck is going on here? No, they're not dead. Nope, there's no blood all over the ground, all over the grass. No scattered bodies. No flies when we talk and walk through the Emanibi village. No bad smell like after our passage yesterday to Decemberry. Oh, it's a bad smell. It draws like the flies. The bad smell, it draws corpse eaters like vultures and hyenas and ants. I don't see any hyenas or vultures who fly around in circles in the air when they smell dead bodies like in Western films. No, they're not dead. Our enemies, they couldn't kill them and leave us alive. That's impossible. The rules say that you should never leave without making sure that everyone is truly, truly dead. That doesn't breathe anymore. You know, true dead is a dead that doesn't move anymore when you poke it with the point of a knife. But there are fake dead who pretend to be dead, who pretend to not breathe anymore, even though they're still breathing softly, softly, softly. You don't watch them breathing? You don't listen to them breathing? So they're not dead, because if they were dead, we would be dead too. Or prisoners, with striped uniforms and heavy ball link chains attached to our feet like the Daltons. They would take our weapons. The camp would be burned. They fled.
Mm-hmm.
It could only be them. The pig roast fires out. They left a while ago. Before the early morning. Before the birds began to sing, because it was the birds who woke me with the songs in the early morning. They woke up before the birds and before us. It was them who woke the birds who woke us up. Or maybe they didn't even sleep. Maybe they ran away from the camp before even going to sleep. They knew before us. They knew that we had lost, that the others had won. They listened to the radio before us, and they fled because they knew that the war is game over. They deserted the camp without even waking us up. Or maybe they tried to wake us up, but we didn't wake up. I mean, me, because of the Jama Jama and the whiskey. Why you? Why didn't you wake up when they maybe woke you up? Because of what commanding officer did to you yesterday? I mean, they fled, so let's flee. There's no one left. Even Goofy, the commanding officer's dog, isn't there anymore. There's only the two of us here. Let's leave. Let's leave right away. Let's leave right now, I'm telling you. Let's flee, because if the others catch us, we are done done. He said that the war is game over. You heard me, like me, you know? And you know what he means. You can't not know what that means, because you heard it too. You heard it. They aren't going to kill us. They aren't going to throw us in prison. They're going to put us in a rehabilitation camp. Just like he said. You hear that? You think that that means nothing to you? I mean, maybe you prefer to be in a rehabilitation camp than to war. But do you even know what a rehabilitation camp is? Do you know what rehabilitation is? If you don't know, it's because you've never read the adventures of Lucky Luke or Western novels. Rehabilitation is when you catch a horse for the first time. Not just any horse. Not a horse like Johnny Jumper, because Johnny Jumper, Lucky Luke's horse, he broke him the first day because they became friends for good. Rehabilitation is when you catch a wicked, wild horse. A horse that no one can ever mount except for a person who caught it first, a Mustang. Oh, do you know who the champion Mustang tamer is? It's Tex Willer. Because Tex Willer jumps on the back of Mustangs, and then the Mustang gets angry and kicks up dirt, and the Mustang cries, "Nay! Nay!" And it's rising its hoofs to the front to throw Tex off, and it balances its two hind hooves to knock Willer off into the rocks. But Willer clings to the Mustang's back, screaming, "Yeehaw! Yeehaw!" And Kit Carson, Tex Willer's friend, goes, "Go, Tex! Go!" tossing his hat in the air. The Mustang foams at the mouth like the animals and the people who were drinking in the river that we poisoned when we executed the Burning River Plan. The Mustangs run all over. All over, like the townspeople running away yesterday when we came into the visit and into the forest to invade their town. The Mustang thrashes and thrashes to the point of exhaustion. And then the Mustang stops, walks hand in hand with Tex Willer. From this day on, he's become a nice domesticated horse because Tex Willer tamed him. That's the way they're going to rehabilitate us. They're going to shut us up in a rehabilitation camp to tame us, the cowboys, the way the cowboys and everyone else tame the Mustang. You know the cowboys really, really, really existed?
Mm.
They're going to put us in a rehabilitation camp because they want to treat us like wild children who need to be tamed. They won't have me in their fucking rehabilitation camp, I'm telling you that, because I'm not a child. And I'm not a savage. The savages? Oh, those are Mustangs. Those are the wildcats, like Battle Cats, He-Man's friends. The savages? Those are the Sioux Indians who attacked the cowboys in the westerns. But they can't take us for savages. Hmm? That's why we need to leave without waiting any longer. And he didn't say anything. The guy on the radio. He had something from us. And I'm telling you, he didn't say everything. If you don't know I'm telling you that, then I'm telling you that because that's what's going on and that's how they're going to put us in the rehabilitation camp. They're also going to put you through drug treatment. Oh yeah, you heard that right. Through drug treatment, they'll put us. To make us never take Jama Jama again. And so we run crazy when we see Jama Jama, or even whiskey. See, I know what I'm talking about. I saw it in a movie. See, you shut someone in a room where they can't take any more powder, like the couscous flour powder that the commanding officer takes morning, noon, and night. Can you imagine the commanding officer without his powder for one day? He'd go crazy, the commanding officer. I mean, he's going to kill all of us, the commanding officer. Like he killed Danny the rat who stole the powder. But in the movie, you know, the man who takes the powder like couscous flour gets angry and starts screaming, "Hey, fuck you! Hey, fuck you!" Afterwards, the man who's taken the powder like couscous flour powder starts trembling like the enemies often did when he pointed weapons at him. The man who's taking the powder like couscous flour powder, he starts crying like the women who were crying when we got caught them in the river. And the man who was taking the powder like couscous flour, he starts to swear what he has done and what he hasn't done so that we give him some of the powder like couscous flour. In the movies, they give the drug treatment to grown-ups. But now they're going to do that to us in the rehabilitation camps. It's not fair. It's not fair because they only do that to kids in rehabilitation camps. They're not even going to put us in the army like they're going to put the grown-ups. Who turn themselves into loyalist forces, but put both arms in the air like Billy the Kid when Lucky Luke catches them. They're going to put those cowards in the army, you realize that? And then they're going to give them real uniforms with real ranks and real salaries. And they're not even going to throw us in prison, because they know that if they throw us in prison, we're going to escape like the Daltons. They're not even going to judge us like the way they judge the grown-ups. You know, to know that they're guilty or not, even though we all know they're always guilty. If they catch us, they're not even gonna say, "You have the right to remain silent. Anything you say will and can be used against you. You have the right to blah, 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 blah." They're gonna treat us like kids. Me, I'm not a child. Me, I'm a grown up.
Do grown ups
grow up and become little again? Maybe grown-ups stop growing up. They grow up. They become grandparents with white hair. And they no longer have teeth like a commanding officer who doesn't have all his teeth even though he's not a grandfather. Why do we have to become little kids again even though we already have pubes? Yep, I already have pubes around my little dango. I'm telling you if you don't know. Even you have pubes. You didn't know that I know that you have pubes already around your little... Babadi. I already saw them. The pubes on your babadi. And they went to take us for kids and they're gonna send us to the rehabilitation camp. And through drug treatment, even though you and I already have pubes. I mean, do kids smoke cigarettes? Do kids smoke Jama Jama? Do kids know how to make war? Who was it who brought the major avalanche to the head of Sergeant Zapata, who wanted to be the commanding officer in the first place, and put in honor of a commanding officer like Vizier is no good, wanted to be the caliph in the place of the caliph? See, they want to take me for a kid, even though Sergeant Zapata was a grown-up, but I brought his home, his head. I took his head off and I brought it back to last week, commanding officer, for his birthday. See, I don't want them to take me for a kid because I'm not a kid. Me. The kids? That's Huey, Dewey, and Louie, Uncle Scrooge's nephews. And even Mowgli, who looks ridiculous in those shorts. I'm not a kid. A child pees in the bed. A child shits their pants so that the grown-ups clean their poopy from their butt. A child drinks their formula and milk while grown-ups drink whiskey and beer, like us. A kid, yeah, they suck candy, or their thumb, or a pacifier, or their mother's breast. But grown-ups? Yeah, grown-ups, they suck the breasts of girls, like the commanding officer was sucking your breasts yesterday. Me crying all the time. A child. Do you ever see me cry? Me. Even when I hurt my forehead. Even when I'm sent to the forced labor camps by the commanding officer to punish me. Did you see me cry? Hey, stop crying and tell me if you ever see me crying. See, you're crying because you want me to make believe that you're a child, but I know that you're not a kid anymore. You're crying because I just said that I saw your body. And I saw your peeps. And I saw the commanding officer sucking on your breast. That's why you're crying. It's not because you're a kid. You're crying because you're a girl. Girls cry all the time, like kids. But I never want to cry again because I'm not a kid anymore. I don't want to be a kid anymore, never, ever.
With you, a thought, memories in fragments, like an air of nostalgia.
Since I was little, I can't stand being taken for a child. And the grown-ups always repeated that a grown-up isn't a child. They like to repeat that when they're bragging. Even Uncle said, you know, grown-up isn't like a little kid to brag about like other grown-ups. He added that, even when a little person grows up, it's not for sure that he will grow. It's Professor Calculus who taught us at school that you say big for big in size and that you say little for little in size. We would say giant or tall, like everyone here says. We would say short or midget, like everyone here says. Do you also say giant or tall? Oh, do you also say short or midget? Even the commanding officer says tall or giant. Even the commanding officer says short or midget. We are tall. The moon gollies are short. That's actually how they're recognized. The moon gollies. That's how they're recognized before even knowing that there's light or dark or handsome or ugly. Before getting close enough to see their scars on their face, they're short first of all. Before listening to them to know that they speak like us, they're short, first of all. They are short. Us, tall. They're even the shorties, and we are even the tall talls. Them, midgets. Us, giants. Mm-hmm. A mark, a tree. But it seems that the giants are the trees, like the trees of the Amazon where the Sioux Indians hid, to attack Tex Willer. And they're the rivers like the long Mississippi or the Missouri and the Adventures of Lucky Luke. It seems that the shrubs that are short and the midget people are like the seven short guys who they found in Snow White's home. Professor Calculus, he took himself for Giro Gearloose, even though he hasn't invented anything to speak of. He took himself for wise, even though he knows nothing. He said the giants don't exist because he hasn't read a book of Davy Crockett or Carrie or Ronin or Tarzan or Conan the Barbarian. He said that you shouldn't treat your commanders and your comrades who are short like midgets and punish us when we made fun of them because he hadn't read Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. Grown-ups don't like to read children's books. Even though me, when I was little, I liked to read grown-up books. Uncle's books when he forgot the key in the house library. The ones with the pictures. They're called cartoons. Professor Calculus, he didn't read children's books. It's why he didn't know that giants and dwarfs existed. One day, he said that grown-ups are big people and that children are little people. And another day, he said that grown-ups are people big in size and all children are short people. Another day, he said that grown-ups are people who are big in size like the ancient sow, and children are people short in size like the pygmies. Even though all the grown-ups aren't big in size, and all children aren't short in size. Even though grown-ups, when they get old, they become short again like O Madibo Mabazaba, our healer, that they call Genifex. Even though he never prepares the right Gaelic magic potion. Professor Calculus, he says that a child could become big by even growing through a dwarf. And dwarfs like Mickey, they wouldn't grow more, and he would never be tall like Davy Crockett, or Conan, or Tarzan. He didn't even know that there were grown-ups with little names, like Little John, Robin Hood's best friend. Even Uncle took himself for a grown-up, even though he was little. Man, I've been grown-up since I was little. Big in every way. Not big like Uncle, who loved to say he was a big person, even though he was little like Joe Dalton. It's because he was short like Joe Dalton that I nicknamed him Uncle Joe Dalton. I mean, if Gomer didn't tell me anything, he never would have known that I had called him Uncle Joe Dalton in secret. And he would have never beat me like he beat me the day he found out I was calling him Uncle Joe Dalton in secret. What did he want, Uncle? I wasn't even going to call him Uncle Arvel Dalton, because Uncle Arvel is tall and dumb. But Uncle was dumb. And not tall. He was dumb. My uncle. Because, you know, he should have been my dad or my real uncle, but Uncle wasn't my real uncle or my real dad. I grew up with Uncle because Dad refused to be my dad. That's what Mom told me. If I hadn't asked her, she would have never told me. And if Gomer hadn't told her that Uncle wasn't my father, but that he was his father, I wouldn't have believed that Uncle was my real father. And it's not for nothing that I nicknamed Gomer, Gomer Goof. He didn't look like the real Gomer Goof because he was short like Uncle, but he was always about to goof up like Gomer Goof. Uncle wanted me to call him Dad, even though he was Uncle Gomer Goof's dad. And even if Uncle Gomer Goof was playing with John Dalton and he hit Uncle Gomer Goof when he said that he wasn't his father, I knew it wasn't true. The grown-ups like to hit their children for nothing. Nothing but because they're grown-up. You hit a child when he tells lies. Uncle John Dalton hit Gomer because he told the truth. Uncle wanted me to call him Dad, even though I knew that he wasn't Dad, and he knew that I knew that he wasn't Dad. I didn't even know why we're here. And now, I still call him Uncle, even though he was never my uncle. But Uncle Joe Dalton, he was meaner than Gargamel. If he wasn't mean, then why did he refuse to let me watch certain movies and he let Gomer Goof watch them? You mean me? I was allowed to watch movies, but I wasn't allowed to watch the other ones. I wasn't supposed to watch the movies where there were a little graphic circle at the bottom of the screen that said PG-13, even though Gomer Goof could watch those with Mom and Uncle. So I would go to my room to read comic books, the ones that my mom bought me. Uncle wouldn't let me watch the movies because he said I was 8. And that I was going to watch the movies when I was 13, even though I knew everything that was in those movies because he left his cabinet open. I watched the movies of PG-13 in the circle at the beginning of the movie. One day, I even saw a movie where it was written 17 and under, not admitted. In the movie, there were some grown-ups, they did some strange things. They were white. They were in a room. There was a man and a woman. And they took off their clothes and they started to do what you were doing yesterday in the grass with commanding officer. But the woman, she went to the man while yesterday you wanted to run. She smiled. And afterwards she started to cry and make this strange sound with her voice. She was pretending to cry. I know she was pretending to cry because tears didn't run down. But when you were really, really crying yesterday, the tears ran down a lot. Uncle came home quickly. I didn't hear the sound. So when I pressed the remote, instead of pressing the stop button, I pressed pause. And the image where the man and the woman were stuck together stayed stuck on the TV. Yeah, I never saw him so angry. He hit me good. He forbade me from watching TV till summer break. And he never left his cabinet open again. Why didn't Uncle want me to watch those movies? Why didn't he want me to wait 8 years just to see a movie, even though there are children like you, you know, who are doing the things that grown-ups do in the movies restricted for those under 18 years old? Even though you'll be 18 in 8 years? Uncle was mean. very mean. He wouldn't let me watch those movies, and he wouldn't buy me a Game Boy. He said that Santa Claus was going to come and bring me a Game Boy at Christmas, even though I know that Santa Claus doesn't exist and that it's him who leaves the presents under the pillow at Christmas. I would pretend to snore, even though I wasn't sleeping, like Gomer Goof, who was snoring even though he was sleeping. Me? I wanted Gomer Goof Game Boy. And in a gift written with my name on it, there was a red horse. And I tried to trade Gomer Goof the Game Boy for the red horse, and he didn't want it. Uncle didn't give me the Game Boy because he was mean. He was very mean, because it's his fault that Mom isn't here anymore. Mom's belly, she started to blow up a lot. A lot. And I asked Mom why her belly was blowing up like the stomach of Patrick Starr. And she told me that I was going to have a little sister. And then one night, Mom started to scream. You know, Uncle took her in her car that night. He still had a car. And he came home late that night crying, even though it was him who had often told me that when we cried, a man doesn't cry. You need to be strong, very strong. Me, I had known for a long time that I was strong, very strong. Because Mom won't come home. She won't come home ever again. Why won't Mom come home? Why won't Mom come home ever again? She's dead. She had a difficult birth, and the doctor did a cesarean on her. When he said cesarean, I thought of Julius Caesar. The evil Julius Caesar in The Adventures of Asterix. What did Julius Caesar do to Mom? The cesarean is an operation to remove the baby from the stomach. Do you know what a cesarean is? If you don't know, I'm gonna tell you. Julius Caesar sliced Mom's stomach open with his sword like an orange and he took out my little sister. But I don't know what he did with her. And my little sister?
Her neither. You will never see her again.
The days passed. There were a lot of people at the house. People in all black, like Zorro. Those people were crying. After 2 days, they put Mom in a casket and they placed me in the middle of the living room. And when they opened the casket, I asked Mom. I knew that she wasn't dead. Uncle had lied to me. He had lied to me, even though he hit us when we lied. Mom wasn't dead. She was sleeping. Do you smile when you're dead? Mm-hmm. No, you smile when you have a good dream. Mom was dreaming, and I wanted to run to Mom. Don't let him get me anybody! The grown-ups who were running there, they always would throw themselves in front of me to prevent me from going to Mom's arms. Why did Uncle say that Mom was a corpse? That wasn't a corpse. It was Mom. My mom. I mean, a corpse is like the mummies in the tomb that, you know, that look like Mom's caskets in The Adventures of Tintin and The Pharaoh's Cigars. A corpse is like those things you see on TV or in movies written with PG-13. A corpse is, it's like the moon galligallies that we killed. Mom wasn't a corpse. Corpses have blood all over, all over. Corpses have their tongues hanging out of their mouth. There are even corpses who piss and shit in their pants when they die. Corpses have flies all over them. Corpses are ugly. The mom was pretty. She looked like Snow White. That's why I wanted to wake her up. She often called me Little Prince, and, you know, I just wanted to give her a kiss like the prince, you know, who wakes up Snow White by giving her a kiss. It's Uncle who prevented me from waking her up because he knew that Mom wasn't a moon golly golly like him. He wouldn't let me near Mom because he was mean like all the moon golly gollies. He's lucky that I haven't seen him again now that I'm 12. Maybe it's even him who sold Mom in witchcraft. Become a big person. Not big in size, because that's impossible that you become big in size. A big person in this country. I'm sure that even the doctor who did the cesarean on Mom was a moon golly-golly.
The moon golly-gollies want to fart on their heads. They are the shortest. They are the bigger ones in the country. But they are ready for anything to become even bigger. It's the commanding officer who was right.
Start. It's here that everything begins. It's here that everything ends. The end of the game. The beginning of I.
There were only three people in the house. Uncle Joe Dalton, Gomer Goof, and Lucky Luke. Oh, I didn't tell you about Lucky Luke yet? Lucky Luke was me. I'm Lucky Luke. It's me. It was what my friends at the School of Champions called me, Lucky Luke. Even if I don't have a horse named Johnny Jumper and a dog named Rantantan Plant, I shoot quicker than my shadow. Even Gomer Goof called me Lucky Luke. Because like Lucky Luke, trapped in the Daltons when they escaped the prison, I often trapped Gomer Goof when he escaped and brought him into the house when Uncle locked us in. And he wouldn't leave us after him. But this time, Uncle, he didn't leave the two of us locked in the house like he does when he go out a lot. He locked himself in with us. For 10 days, Uncle stayed locked in with us all day. It had been like a month since Uncle had gone back to work, but for 10 days, he didn't go to work, even though he wanted us to come back to the house. And even though we wanted him to go to work, we couldn't be alone in the house, so he stayed. We were supposed to take Christmas vacation soon, but for 10 days, we didn't go to school. Even though me, I wanted to go to school. Even Gomer Goof didn't like school, but he wanted to go to school. Before the light days, where there was no school, but, you know, we wanted to go to school because we hadn't gone to school for 10 days, but for 10 days, we couldn't play anymore. Like during vacation. For 10 days, we couldn't go play at our houses of our friends. Like during vacation. You know, for 10 days, we couldn't leave to go to the carousel or to the movies or to the park or to the zoo with Uncle. Like during vacation. For 10 days, we were shut inside, and he would say, everything is dangerous.
Why can't you speak loudly anymore?
It's dangerous to make noise.
Why can't you open the window anymore?
It's dangerous to open the window.
Even if it's warm.
Even if it's hotter than the Sahara Desert.
Why are we going to school anymore?
It's too dangerous to go to school.
But you're the one who said that I had to go to school to be big and when I grow up, didn't you?
Yes, it wasn't so dangerous to go to school. But it wasn't so dangerous to want to be a grown-up.
So, I'm not going to become prime minister when I grow up anymore?
Now, it would be dangerous for you to go to school and become even the least of the ministers. Since it's dangerous to go to school, why can't you?
Why can't we watch TV with you anymore?
It's dangerous for children to watch TV these days.
Why is it dangerous for children to see what the grown-ups see on TV these days?
Because children can have nightmares if they see what grown-ups see on TV these days.
If you sleep with the lights on like before, you won't have any nightmares.
I strictly forbid you from lighting that light.
Even at night?
Above all at night.
Why?
Because it's dangerous.
Why is it dangerous?
Because they will know that we are here. And that they are very dangerous.
Who? Uncle didn't respond. Did you choose?
There are more things dangerous than the jujus. You're lying!
I didn't say that directly to him. I said that to myself. I spoke it in my heart because you should never tell a grown-up that they're lying, but that what they say isn't true. Grown-ups never lie. It's just untruths that slip from their mouths.
Now go join your brother in the bedroom. I want to watch the news.
I left to go to bed, but I knew that Uncle was lying. I mean, even Gomer knew that my father was lying, and he had been saying that for 10 days, which wasn't true. He was hiding something from us. No one could be more dangerous than the jujus. You know about the jujus. All kids know about the jujus!
What? Oh, come on! Even when I was a kid, I was afraid of the jujus.
Even a kid, if they've never seen a juju, he knows the jujus by heart. The jujus? They're large like Denver the dinosaur. Giant like King Kong. Ugly like Shrek with long claws like Kimba the White Lion. Green skin like Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. Pointy ears like King Piccolo. Big eyes like Spider-Man, big red lips like the blacks in the Adventures of Tintin in the Congo, teeth that resemble the swords of the Knights of Zodiac, and mouths that spit fire like dragons. I've already seen a juju, me. And not in a dream, in reality, really. Really, really. A lot of jujus invaded the forest we were chasing. They start chasing me, and I'm not afraid of them. I open fire. The bullets bounce off their chest, and they had the power of superheroes. They launch blazes of light at me like Street Fighter. Boom! And I slipped away like Mortal Kombat. Jump to the left, bounce to the right, and I continue to fire them. Juju knocked me off my back and hit me from behind out of cowardice. When I woke, there were no more jujus. Uncle wasn't afraid of the jujus because he was afraid of the people that were more dangerous than the jujus. He would go out sometimes, even though he said that the dangerous people could pop out of anywhere, hit and disappear in the forest. He went out alone. He locked us in first. He didn't lock us in the living room anymore, but in the bedroom. You know, by pressing our ears to the bedroom door, we heard him close the living room door. And afterwards, we heard him open the door of the living room and then open the door of the bedroom. I mean, he often came back with rice and peanut sauce. He always came back with rice and peanut sauce. Only rice and peanut sauce. Rice and peanut sauce every day. Because before we'd been locked up, Uncle, he didn't know how to cook like before. So he made the same thing every day. Rice and peanut sauce. And then rice and peanut sauce was no longer good like rice and peanut sauce from before. One day, Gomer cried because there was no fish in the sauce. One day, I cried because there was no meat in the sauce. But I didn't cry. One day, there wasn't even salt in the sauce. One day, there were even pebbles in the rice. One day, the peanut sauce was all black, and one day, there was only rice and no peanut sauce. And he made us eat it all. And we had to eat it, because, you know, we were no longer eating morning, noon, and night, but only at night. And one day, we even went 2 days without eating. And we drank water that tastes like well water. Every day, Uncle gently opened the window, looked out, and closed it quickly. Uncle often watched TV alone. He listened to the radio alone. And as soon as he said,
I want to watch the news, as soon as he said, I want to listen to the news, we ran into the bedroom,
his bedroom. One night, the 10th night, the last night, Uncle had finished listening to the news. Uncle had finished watching the news. We had finished praying, and we had been in bed for a while. And I wasn't sleeping yet, even though Gomer Goof was sleeping like Uncle. I was having nightmares with my eyes open, even though Gomer Goof was having nightmares with his eyes closed. He always had nightmares, Gomer. He was always waking up, screaming, Gomer. Well, me, I had nightmares, but with my eyes open, but I don't scream. In my nightmares, I saw 17 Jujus entering the room through the keyhole, one by one. See, I heard them with my own eyes like I see you. I counted well. I heard well. Firecrackers! Ha! Sudden firecrackers! See, I thought that it was the Jujus who farted the firecrackers. We heard the firecrackers. Everyone jumped out of bed. Uncle John Dalton, Gomer Goof, and me. All of a sudden, the Jujus disappeared. The Jujus don't like grown-ups. And, you know, they come out when they're kids, but they hide as soon as a grown-up is even there. No more Jujus in the room. But the firecrackers didn't stop. We heard them in the night. Boom! 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 And the screams of men left to right. Pow! 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 And the screams of women and children. Woo! It's already Christmas?
No. It's them.
Who?
The Revelo.
Uncle opened the window slightly and bent in to see. And we two, we went in behind him to see what he wanted to see. We saw. We saw what he saw. Even though he closed up really quickly, so we didn't see what he saw. I want to see. Me too. I love fireworks.
You can't go out.
That's not fair.
There's also screams of children.
Yes, there are children like us who scream with the grown-ups. Uncle looked us in the eyes.
My children. My poor children. That glow that your innocent eyes saw, it's not fireworks, but houses on fire. The houses that the revelers set fire to in the city. That which your innocent ears hear, those aren't firecrackers, but gunshots. They are in the process of killing people with machine guns. They're in the process of cutting people up with machete. They are in the process of burning everything in the neighborhood. The screams you hear, those are the screams of people who are afraid. Men, women, children. Yes, children like you. And even smaller children than you that the Revelos are massacring without pity. We are lost, my children. If they find us, we are lost for good. Only baby Jesus can save us. Gomer starts to cry. He's a real chicken, Gomer. You both be brave.
Me? You know, I don't know why he told him to both be brave. You both be brave. Just be brave, Uncle should have said. Because me, I wasn't crying. I wasn't afraid. I was never afraid. I'm fearless, like John the Fearless, and valiant, like Prince Valiant. You know, Uncle took us in his arms, and he carried us to the living room. The sounds of the firecrackers only got closer. Uncle raced to one of the walls of the house, and there were framed photos of the whole family. He took down pictures of the family. He took down his photo, he took down a photo of Gomer, and he took down a photo of all four of us. Him, Mom, Gomer, and me. And he left two photos next to one another on the wall. The one of Mom, where she was smiling in the dark with the gap white in her teeth. My photo, where I was the most handsome in the parade. He took out the photo album and he approached me. And the noises, man, they got closer to the house. My son. His hands trembled.
are the only chance of survival. Even his voice trembled. You alone can save us.
Why did he say that to me, Uncle? When he just said that only baby Jesus can save us. So I'm more powerful than baby Jesus.
I always told myself that. Besides, baby Jesus isn't powerful. That's why he doesn't like fights.
He said that if somebody slaps you with your right cheek and you offer him your left cheek to slap you again. Me? If somebody slapped me on one of my cheeks, whether it was the left or the right cheek, I'd slap him too. And I'd beat him good like I beat up Pinocchio that day when he hit me with his left hand on my right cheek. The school of champions, they called Uncle in, and Uncle grounded me, but no one dared hit me again.
Forgive me, son. My son. But if they don't find anyone, they will burn the house to the ground. If they find you with us, they will kill us all, believing that you are like us. But they find you alone, without us, all three of us have a chance of surviving.
Gomer started to cry again.
And Uncle picked up Gomer and they ran into the bathroom.
Whatever happens, you're alone. Don't forget.
The noises were already at the front door, and they started to bang on the front door. The noises on the door wasn't knock-knock, but boom, boom! And then the door cracked, crack, crack, and two men entered. One had a machine gun, and the other a machete. One of the two had a big can of petrol. And the one with the machine gun, he looked like Captain Haddock with his beard. And the one with the machete, he looked like Popeye with his big arms and lots of body hair. He didn't have a pipe, but a cigarette. It smelled bad. They had military pants ripped up, and old, dirty clothes. And I saw them clearly in the dark. Them, they didn't see me in the dark. It's why they turned the light on in the living room. They saw me frozen in the middle of the living room. They looked at me, and I looked at them. They thought that they made me afraid. I wasn't afraid. They started looking everywhere. In the bedroom, they pulled everything up. In the uncle's room, they knocked everything down. In the kitchen, they pushed everything over. And in the living room, they chucked everything out. And when they wanted to go to the bathroom, I placed myself in the middle of their block, the path there. Captain Haddock, he lifted me up and just set me to the side. And there was no one in the bathroom. Uncle and Gomer had disappeared. I know where they were. They were in the ceiling. They lifted up a piece of the ceiling and they entered and then closed it up. I knew this hiding spot. I hid there often when I was playing hide and seek with Gomer, and he never knew that I knew it. Even Uncle never knew that I knew his hiding spot. Where are your parents? Mama's dead, I said to myself. Dad refused to be my dad, I said to myself. Uncle Joe Dalton is hiding in the ceiling, but he's not my dad, I said to myself. So, I don't have any parents. This is why I didn't answer. I looked at the photo of Mom. She told me not to be afraid. Not to answer. They looked at the photograph at the same time. Mom was smiling. Popeye, he took it down. Took the photo of Mom, and I thought they were going to hurt it. And I was ready to jump up and protect it. But Mom continued to smile. She was mocking them. They looked at the photo, they looked at me, and then he said something strange, like in a strange language. Oh, a language I didn't speak, that I didn't hear, but I understand very well. They looked back at the photos of Mom and me, they looked back at me. They are ours, one said to the other, moving away from the photo.
Even say there's no doubt about it.
Why are you alone? I'm not alone, idiot. I'm with Uncle Joe Dalton and Gomer Goof, I told myself. But I said nothing. Are you stupid or what? Can't you see he's a bastard?
Where's his mother?
Well, answer for God's sakes. Your mouth smells, I said to the other one without speaking. And I cut off my breath, like when I'm in the swimming pool.
Do you think he doesn't care about us?
Tell me, kid, is it possible that you don't give a fuck about us? Yes, I said in my heart. And I stuck my tongue out without opening my mouth, like when I make fun of Gomer sticking my tongue out.
Is he deaf or mute or both?
He's just brave. I'll go even further. There's a true son of Kibibidi in his place. A little moon god Gali would already be crying for his mother. One said of them, they said it to each other and they were opening a bottle. I wanted to tell them to not touch that bottle because it was one of the bottles that Uncle only opened when he had real guests. But I said nothing. I knew what was going to happen to them. They started drinking. And outside, there were still firecrackers. Drinking. Outside, there were still screams. Drinking. Outside, there were still fireworks. Drinking. And when they had already drunk two bottles, they started to speak like grown-ups speak when they drink a lot of crazy water. And when grown-ups drink a lot of crazy water, they start talking like fools. Even Uncle became foolish with his guests when he drank a lot of crazy water.
Why does this young Kibibili live alone, will you think?
His mother works nights, no doubt. I'll go even further. A Kibibili, all alone with her son in the barracks like this, she can only be a good type girl.
Hey, little man, tell him that you're the son of a whore.
That's the hand you dealt with to a sister in this country. I'll go even further. They want them all to become sluts. Luckily, we give it to them good, their slut sisters, before we trap them. The first one was becoming much crazier than the other fool and pulled me towards him.
Come here, little man. Come drink a little.
The first one said to me, he opened my mouth and I clenched my teeth strongly to try not to drink. I didn't want to become crazy like them. He pressed my cheeks together and made me open my mouth, and I opened my mouth. And I closed my mouth tightly. Very tightly. Ow! The first one, yeah, he screamed. He had dropped the bottle, which broke down. He started to blow on his finger. And I laughed in my heart without moving my lips. And the second one lifted his machete.
Let it fall!
He's a brave Kibibidi. I would go even further, I said to myself at the same time as him. I said that in my heart while he said it out loud. I knew that that's what he was going to say, I would go even further, because that made me think too much of their, I would go even further, like Thompson and Thompson, who were called the Thompson Twins in The Adventures of Tintin. He would make a really good reveler, said the first one, who's now feeling my arm. As he squeezed my arm like a papaya, I tightened my muscles like Conan the Barbarian. Second fool, he dropped his machete. He was afraid. Then a telephone resembled them, and the telephone rang. It was a telephone of, like, my school friend of Lix's military father. He started to say things that I didn't understand. He was speaking in a language he spoke at the beginning, the language that my mother often spoke with Uncle Jeremy, the language that my dad, you know, who refused to be my dad. And I could only understand loyalists, army, repeated many times. Retreat, they're coming.
Do we burn the house or do we burn the house?
We don't burn anything. His mother was one of ours. I'll go even further. When she returns, she will know that he's alive and he can come back to share his exploits with her later, after we win. He carried me over the shoulder. I fought back. Him? He ran as if I wasn't fighting. They ran in the same direction as many of the men dressed like them, with machine guns and machetes. oranges or wet earth like our neighborhood. Our neighborhood smelled like when Mom burned off the fur of the bushmeat that she sometimes prepared. There was no longer people walking in our neighborhood. There were no longer people running around in our neighborhood. There were no longer the color of the dirt in our neighborhood. The dirt had become red in our neighborhood. There were people asleep all over. Like all over the red dirt of our neighborhood. And we crossed the whole neighborhood. We ran a long, long, long time. We entered the forest, and when we finally got there in the middle of the forest, we stopped running. When we arrived, it's nighttime, and in the middle of the day in the forest, they started to walk. Then they started to laugh. Then they started to sing. And they sang raising their fists in the air. They sang raising their machetes in the air. They sang raising their machine guns in the air. There were even children who sang with them. Children who were like them. The other children, they cried. The other children that they had captured that were like me were crying. There were my friends from the neighborhood. There were children I'd never seen before. Boys like me, girls like you who were crying like you were crying here. You, that you hadn't arrived yet. Everyone was crying. I didn't know why they were crying. A grown-up laughs when another grown-up laughs without knowing why they laugh. But a child cries when another child cries without knowing why they cry. That's why I also began to cry. I wasn't afraid. I'm never afraid. It's because the other children were crying that I cried. Yeah, but that was a long time ago. I was still a child. The first day that they brought me before the commanding officer.
Play. Like a poker game, or solitaire, or checkers. Or where whoever loses wins.
War is like a game, the commanding officer said the first day. It's a game when you get hurt. It's also, and above all, a game of kill or be killed. War is a game, but it's anything but a child's game. As you know, every game has rules. First rule, I don't want to hear that you are children ever again because you are grown-ups. The commanding officer, he said again and again and again, marching before Rose like Bugs Bunny, the director of our school who marched because every Monday morning to check our uniforms to make sure they were clean. And the names embroidered on them and our faces shaven so that we were worthy of singing the national anthem. If an adult shoots at a kid and the bullet hits him there in the forehead, what happens?
He dies!
A kid in the front row, commanding officer was leaning towards him, looking for an answer. If a kid shoots an adult and the bullet hits through the tarp, what happens?
He dies?
I answered, looking at the man. I was looking at him, the image of a man smoking a fat cigar in a red coat. The man who looked like Jesus, but with a beard and who wore a beret with a star.
You know that the bullets of a child kills like that of a child and an adult. In a week, at most, you will become soldiers. You will hear it said that you are child soldiers. But remember that you are not child soldiers, but real soldiers. Because war is an adult affair. You are fearsome rebels ready to defend the Kimberley cause. Is that clear?
Yes, commanding officer!
We all gave commanding officer Stampede in unison. That was the first day of our military service. The first day of our military service, I shot a gun for the first time. First day, I fell with a shotgun. The second day, the shotgun fell, and I remained standing. The third day, the man-shaped target fell.
Very good, good,
the commanding officer said, standing up to the target. I fired, and the target fell. Five times, the commanding officer stood the target up. Five times, the commanding officer moved the target further away. Five times, the target fell.
Good, very good, perfect, wonderful.
The commanding officer said, slapping me so strongly on the shoulder like he did with Captain Haddock when he showed him the finger that I bit. The commanding officer said that we would become soldiers in 1 week. I became a soldier in 3 days. And after 3 days, commanding officer said I was ready. He even said, good, two, go. While others wasted more and more bullets firing in the air, the shooting range, he said that I was a soldier. He gave me a military uniform, because not everyone could be He-Man or Conan. You know, lives in shorts and a bare chest, and was never cold or afraid of huge mosquitoes in the forest. He gave me boots, because, you know, not everyone could be Tarzan or Mowgli or Caracou. You know, walk barefoot among huge thorns in the forest, and never prick. He gave me a shotgun like Lucky Luke's, because not everyone is Ronan the Son of the Stone Age who lives in a forest with only his little ivory cutlass to protect himself from, you know, huge animals like mammoths and nasty like saber-toothed tigers. All that was left and all that was missing was a name for me. When I told the commanding officer that my name was Paul, he told me that that was a biblical name and that I should erase that first name from my name because he liked Paul in the Bible, but Paul in the Bible disappointed him because he stopped killing people to become an apostle. I needed a soldier's name, a name that resonated, an explosive name, killer name, a name that gave courage, that fear strokes in others. I told him that at school, the School of Champions, you know, people called me Lucky Luke. The commanding officer laughed. Listen, little one, if you're as thin as Lucky Luke and as thin as most of us, it's because the Kimbililis are naturally thin. It's because of most of the Moongangalis who starve us while they stuff their faces. Luckily for you, that's almost over. Thanks to the brave soldiers like you. He also said that there was a warning for me, and we should talk about it later. One day, we attacked the first Moongangali village. It wasn't a little village that looked like the Smurfs village, and when they saw us coming out of the grass, they ran for it, screaming. We were behind them, like a coyote is chasing a roadrunner. They headed to school. We followed them into the school. The commanding officer was right. The war is easy. It's as easy as a love. I mean, you advance like in Star Wars, avoiding obstacles like in Mario Brothers. And, you know, the one with the rocket launcher fired at the wall, and the cinder blocks disappeared like the balls of Zuma. And the wall tumbled down like in Tetris. And you just push a button and someone falls down, like the target fell in the shooting range. The difference is then the blood pours out. Pours out. Not like the cartoon characters who never die when they fall off a building. But we returned home singing the song that they had taught us. We found the commanding officer who was waiting for us at camp because he didn't take part in the battle. He never takes part in the battle, commanding officer Stampede. He always sends us with Captain Haddock, who's really the captain, but isn't named Captain Haddock. The war name of Captain Haddock is Captain Beelzebub. Captain Beelzebub told Commanding Officer Stampede that I killed 3 men. The commanding officer was very proud of me. He opened a bottle of crazy water. And that's the first time I drank whiskey for the first time. That's the day I learned that crazy water makes you stronger. That's the day that I smoked for the first time. That's the day that I knew that Jama Jama makes you brave. But the cigarettes didn't stay stuck in my mouth like Lucky Luke's cigarette that stays stuck in his mouth even when he speaks. My cigarette fell out as soon as I opened my mouth. Then the captain named me Corporal. He picked up my shotgun that shoots one bullet at a time, like Lucky Luke's shotgun, and he gave me a Kalashnikov that fires many bullets at once. He said that from this day on, my name was Corporal Boy Killer. And since that day, I have a kalash, while the other soldiers who were there before me still have machetes and shotguns. The ones that Leonardo the Genius, our blacksmith Machir, makes himself. You know that a kalash is unforgiving, right? A kalash? Doesn't banter. And that's why you have to obey when I tell you that we're leaving, or else I'll do to you what I did to a lot of the Moongali Gala girls when I trapped them. I track them? You know that I got stuck together with them. I never got stuck together with them, like certain Revelos. I can't defy myself getting stuck together with a Moon Golly Golly. I did to them what I did to the Moon Golly Golly boys. Without pity. Because the enemy is the enemy. And us, we are the enemy's enemy. And who are our enemies? It's every Moon Golly Golly without exception, boy or girl, big or small, elderly or baby. And that's what they want to do to us. You aren't one of them, so if you're not with them, you're against them. And so you aren't against them, you're with us. Even though we're alone now. You and me. Let's go. Okay, I'm gonna give you 3 seconds. And I'm gonna count the seconds starting now. 3, 2, 1. One time? Just one time? Just one time. Boy Killer was supposed to shoot, and he didn't shoot. Boy Killer was supposed to beat a Moon Golly Golly, but he didn't beat them. It was a year after I became a Revelo. And I'd already killed a lot of resistant Moon Golly Gollies. I already slit a lot of Moon Golly Golly's throats to avenge Uncle Jeremy. I'd already done a lot of Moon Golly Golly women the way Julius Caesar did my mother. And one day, we attacked a truck like the Daltons attacked the stage coaches. Then it was night. A truck full of Moon Golly Golly refugees. And they fled into the forest, and we chased them into the heart of the forest. It was a forest with a lot of vines, like the forests of Tarzan, Mowgli, and Black Panther. And we looked for them. Looked for them, dead or alive, among the trees. Those who were alive, you have to make sure they're dead so that their brothers don't find them alive. And we trapped them all. But we didn't just kill them right away. There's no wreckage or need to wreck the ammunition to kill a Moon Golly Golly when you can kill them economically. Beelzebub said that day. I'll go even further. The life of a Moon Golly Golly isn't worth the price of a cartridge. Lieutenant Chop Chop added, thinking he would behead them with his machete. You know, to save the cartridges, we hang them from the vines that hung from the trees like the cowboys hang the wine. We didn't hang them ourselves. We ordered somebody else to hang them. Some preferred to hang themselves. We executed them all because it was necessary to kill them all. I lifted up a tuft of grass. We were ready to leave. And I heard a small sound in the bushes. I stumbled upon a child sleeping. It's a Moon Golly Golly. The child got up slowly, and he had lots of tears in his eyes. He was short. He was thin, very thin. He was the only survivor. Me in the eyes, and I looked him in the eyes. He smiled, even though he had tears. I didn't smile. He looked at my kalash. The kalash looked at him. The tears started to run down his cheek, and he trembled like a leaf. He took 2 steps back, and he started to run. Turned around, he fell down. He got up. He started to run again. He fell down again. He got up again. He started to run again, and he fell down again, and he got up again. And he started to run again, like Speedy Gonzales. And he didn't fall down again. Shoot, 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 for the love of God, shoot the gun. Captain Beelzebub screamed from the distance. I stayed like a statue. I didn't move. I didn't lift my weapon. What did you do, poor fool? Captain Beelzebub hurled. He reported to the commanding officer, Stampede. The commanding officer, Stampede, gave it to me good. Boy, kill him! There are moon gullygullies that you let escape will kill you the first chance they get, the commanding officer said. He decided from that day on that his dog, Goofy, would always accompany us to make sure that none of them would ever escape. And since that day, the commanding officer's dog, Goofy, you know, the commanding officer's ugly dog who looks like the commanding officer, accompanied us on the raids. The commanding officer put us on duty. Put me on duty. Because I disobeyed orders. I didn't shoot. But I should have. I mean, I couldn't shoot. Even though I could have, I recognized him. He recognized me. It was him. It was Gomer. Gomer Goof, my brother, like Uncle said. My brother, like Mother said. And Gomer and me, we were like Tom and Jerry. It was my brother, even if he was an idiot. You're not Gomer, so don't be an idiot. Stop looking at me like Alice. We're not in Wonderland here. Follow me, or else there'll be trouble. Let's leave from here. To go where? You're asking yourself, I know. I don't know myself. But let's go away anyways. I don't know. Anywhere. If you don't come right away, I'll do something to you that they do in PG-13 movies. In the movies, where it's written PG-13, the actor kills his brother in arms so that the enemy doesn't have to find him alive. That's when the brother is wounded and he can't run anymore. And it's because the wounded brother himself, it's him who asks the actor to kill him because his foot is wounded and because he can't run anymore. And the actor kills him. Crying. But me, I can't kill you because you didn't ask me to. And even if you ask me to kill you, I can't kill you because you're a girl. And you're Kim and Billy. But even if you didn't ask me to kill you, and even if you're a girl, and even if you're Kim and Billy, I'm going to kill you all the same if you don't follow me, so follow me! The game is over, so stop your little game or else it will be game over.
Makes you thirsty, the thirst of a hunger, the hunger for a hand.
Do you want me to get upset? You know that I'm already upset? I'm not gonna get even more upset if you don't stop right away. Just stop spitting, I tell you. Stop spitting like my mouth stinks. Look at my teeth. Huh. Take a good look at my teeth. Do I have yellow teeth? Me? Do I have teeth like the commanding officer? My mother hit me morning and night to make me brush my teeth so they wouldn't turn yellow, like the yellow teeth of the commanding officer, who doesn't have teeth at all, when I saw him kiss you with his mouth, with his yellow teeth. So stop acting as if I stink, and stop acting like you're gonna throw up. Even if you wanna throw up, I forbid you from throwing up. Stop throwing up, it's disgusting. A girl who throws up, throw up! Fine, throw up. Throw up if you want to. Throw up.
but then don't even think because you pretend to throw up, I'm gonna leave you there. I can't leave you. I can't leave you there. I'm setting out, I don't know where, whether you want it or not. I know what you're doing, and I know why you're doing that. It's because you want me to take pity on you. Girls always want you to take pity on them. Me? I don't pity you because I don't pity anyone. I'm a rebel. Even if I hold it. Fine. Even if you hold your stomach like you're holding your stomach there, I know that you're pretending to be sick to the stomach. If you really, really, truly are sick, take a dump. And stop making me shit, or else it's on your stomach that my kolache is going to piss. I'm turning. So that I don't see you shitting, but don't do anything stupid. Because when Boy Killer says he'll shoot, he shoots, and he doesn't miss. He never misses. So it's in your interest to shit while I'm pissing, because if it doesn't come, you're coming. So is it coming? I don't hear anything. I don't smell anything. You gotta feel me if you don't shit. I know what you're saying to yourself. You're saying that I want to take you far away because you're a girl, and I want to get stuck together with you because boys always want to get stuck together with girls. It's because you think that I want to get stuck together with you like commanding officer, that you're pretending to be sick to your stomach. It's even what you want. That I get stuck together with you. But I don't want to get stuck together with you because I'm a hero and heroes don't like girls. It's the girls who love the heroes. And heroes always run away from the girls who love them in the end of movies or in cartoons. Because a girl, when a girl falls in love with a hero, she wants to get stuck together with him all the time, and he can't be a real hero because he has to get stuck together with her like chewing gum. You know, sometimes the wife of a hero is even taken to the movies where it's written PG-13, and the hero can no longer save the world because he has to just save his wife. That's why Lucky Luke, as soon as a girl falls in love with him, always runs away in the end, singing, I'm a poor, lonesome cowboy. Even Black the Rock always runs away from girls who fall in love with him. Only Nicky Larson loves girls, but girls don't love him. Only Tarzan has a wife named Jane, like Calamity Jane from The Adventures of Lucky Luke, but me, I don't like The Adventures of Tarzan like I like The Adventures of Lucky Luke and Calamity Jane. So I can't get stuck to you. I'm not the commanding officer. Do you think that they killed the commanding officer? Oh, it's not fair. It's me who was supposed to kill the... me, who was supposed to kill him the day when he was supposed to go and do the thing again, the thing that the grown-ups do in the movies that are forbidden for under 18. Maybe the commanding officer knew that I was going to kill him and ran away. I was going to empty my entire kolache in him. Today, even. I was going to come back to show his nuts to all the rebelos today, even. And the other rebelos were going to be even more afraid of me because they were going to know that if I cut off the commanding officer's nuts, then I had bigger nuts than him and them put together. That my magic is more powerful than the commanding officer's magic, and that now the power of the voodoo that was more powerful than all the voodoo had been added to my voodoo. Captain Beelzebub was going to be happy because he secretly detested the commanding officer. But the commanding officer didn't know that, even though I did. He detested the commanding officer because he was afraid of him, even though me, I detested the commanding officer, but I wasn't afraid of him. It was me who was going to decide who would become who, and no one was going to dare to do anything about it or debate it. I was going to become his right-hand man. I was going to become lieutenant in the place of Lieutenant Chop Chop, who died yesterday's attack. And no one would ever dare touch you.
never and ever. That's what was gonna happen today. Like the war, it's game over and no one will ever dare touch you because you are with me and I'm there for you. But don't think that it's to do what the commanding officer was doing to you. And don't think that it's because you're a girl. Don't think that's because I'm jealous. Don't think that's because you're ugly that I don't want to get stuck together with you. You're beautiful. You're the most beautiful girl in camp. You're the most beautiful girl of all the relatives. The most beautiful Kimmy Biddy. You look like my mom with the white teeth and the gap in the middle. That's why even though you're the only girl on Earth, like Smurfette is the only girl in the Smurf Village, I could never get stuck with you. You're my sister. I'm your brother. Yes, you're my little sister and I'm your older brother. I knew it the first day. First day I saw you. My little sister who left with mom, see, I didn't know what she looked like, but I know what you look like. And I think you look like her. I know you look like my little sister with left of mom. I'd never seen you, but I recognized you as soon as I saw you. You came back through reincarnation. It's Harry Potter, my friend who left the village to join the Revelos because they wanted to kill him, accusing him of being a child wizard. He's the one who first told me of the reincarnation. He told me that one day, when a baby dies, it always comes back. It comes back to a different family. And that's why he wanted to die, to be born into another family. He died the other day on the battlefront. But he's not good. He's not dead for good. He's left to be born into a real family. Yeah, you, the family where you were born into isn't your real family. It's me. I'm your real family. I'm your only family. And you, you are now my only. You know what I'm talking about? I made a wish one day when I saw a shooting star in the sky. You always have to make a wish when you see a shooting star in the sky because a shooting star is like Aladdin's magic wand. You make a wish and the star in the sky, you make it wish like a real genie in the stove in the lamp. Shooting star, let my little sister come back and let me find her. That's what I said to the star. And the next day, I saw you in the area that the Moon Golly Golly had just attacked. And we were coming in there to rescue you, and they had been left there before we got here. And you were hiding in that abandoned house. The old one? You were afraid. You thought it was them again. I saw you. Shaking, you were crying, and I knew it was you. I knew that it was my little sister, and I caught myself. I brought you to the forces of Captain Beelzebub. Come here, or I'll shoot, I said, pointing to Kalashichu. I couldn't have fired even if I couldn't. I couldn't fire my little sister. I'm not Moon Golly Golly. It's them who kill their kids on their parents or their brothers or their sisters with witchcraft so that they can have houses of theirs to become the caves of Alibaba and the 40 Thieves. It's Moon Golly Gollies who sold mothers in witchcraft to become like Scrooge McDuck. Watch over your little sister, Mom said. That's what she said in the morning when the birds came out. And that's why I didn't want to leave you here, even if I could. That's why I can't leave you there, even if I wanted to. Because now, I'm your big brother. So we are like Kimbo and Keita, Bart and Laura Simpson. Nothing else can happen to you. I'll kill anyone who tries to kill you. What happened to you? Well, one would say you're pissing yourself, but one would say that that's not pee-pee. It doesn't smell like pee-pee. Let me see your baba. Lift up your stomach. Lift up your dress. Show me your stomach, little sister. I mean, you refused to eat the barbecue yesterday. You haven't eaten since the day before yesterday, even though you cook every day with the other girls in camp.
You haven't eaten, but why is your stomach the way like you eat a lot? Why is your stomach bizarre, like Mom's stomach that became like Patrick Starr's stomach? You're not gonna do that to me. You're not gonna do that to me, little sister. You're not gonna do it too. Who's gonna take care of you here if you do that? Even Gataflex, he fled with the others. Oh man, there's no one left in this camp. There's only the three of us here. You, me, and my collage. There's not even a camp anymore that I can turn into. Or turn myself into the Loyalist forces or to the Blue Helmets, because they're gonna want to take away my collage and me, and I'll take life over anyone who wants to take away my collage, because it's straight to reform school for me, and I don't want to go to reform school, and I'm not gonna go to any other camp.
Wade. I know what we're gonna do. I'll hide my collage here. I'll hide my knife here. I'll hide my soldier uniform here. And you won't tell anyone at all, okay? And not even in a dream. And I'll take you to a place not far from here, to a refugee camp. There's lots of people, refugees, you know, from the war that go into hiding. Children, grown-ups too. Don't tell anyone that we're Revelos. We were never in the war, us. It's the war that affected us. And we were running away so the war can't continue to affect us so much. I never killed anyone. We're running away so that no one kills us. Okay? You're pretending to be afraid. Me too. I'm pretending to be afraid. Even though I'm not afraid. I'm never afraid. But what makes me mad is that we'll be mixed. Moongalligallis and Kimbibillis mixed together in the same camp, like we're mixed together in this country. That's why we never attacked the refugee camp, to kill other Kimbibillis. We'll be safe there because the Moongalligalli won't attack us either. Or else they would be killing other Moongalligallis. What's more, is if one or two of the camps were attacked the other refugee camp, the UN would get really, really angry and create Security Council to place you in security. The UN, it's a mixture of all the countries in the world. The Security Council is the meeting of all the counselors who give counsel at the UN to secure the council of the people who keep the world secure. And when the counselors of the Security Council get the UN counselor mad, the UN gets super ugly mad. And then they send white, black, yellow, red, Matiso militaries that are called Blue Helmets. They're the ones who guard the refugee camps. They are sophisticated weapons that fire 1,000 bullets a second. And that could lead into the World War. That would be the World War for you. Because all the countries of the entire world enter the fight on the side of the UN to make a world war. The USSR, Russia, Belarus, Lebanon, Pakistan, Afghanistan, Kazakhstan, the Vatican, Sudan, Vietnam, Vietcong, East Germany, West Germany, South Germany, North Germany, the North Pole, the South Pole, South Africa, Asia Minor, Asia Minor, the Queen of England, the King of Morocco, the King of Spain, even General de Gaulle and all the Gauls of the war, even Tex Willers America will join the war, even Rome, Julius Caesar's country will join the war, even Jerusalem, the country of Jesus of Nazareth will join the war, the Chinese with Kung Fu, the Indians with the arrows, the Mexican pisteleros with their sombreros, the blacks with their machetes, the pirates of the Caribbean, the cowboys, the samurais, the Vikings, the hunters, the red tunics, the red berets, the dragons, the jujus, the Martians, Son Goku, Spider-Man, Batman, Iron Man, the X-Men, the Fantastic Four, Thor and the Avengers, the Planet of the Apes, and the World War will become the Star War. And during the war, there are only journalists who are in the war zone, like the ones who show up in the war, that say that the war is game over. Them too, the commanding officer, strictly forbid us from touching them, because like he forbade us from attacking the refugee camp, he says we can't attack the journalists because the journalists are not in the war for making war, but for commentating on the war and for saying who's winning. You know, like journalists who are commentating on soccer matches to say who's winning. When the war is game over, like he said, and when the journalist who says the war is that it's game over, that's what they mean, that it's game over. Oh, game over? Oh, that means no more clashes, no more surprise attacks, no more face-to-face, no more jama jama, no more whiskey, no more money, no more perfume and jewelry. The things that I was going to start to keep from today on for my little sister after the pillage. But the refugee camp? Oh, it's better than rehabilitation camps, you'll see. The refugee camp? It's better than our camp. There are Red Cross doctors. Those who wear clothes with the crosses, which isn't like the cross with the little Jesus that the priest like Friar Tucker wear yesterday, but a cross that's red like the blood of the revolution, even though they're not revolutionaries. Them too. You should never attack them or the UN station, because they aren't in the war to shed blood, but to heal the people with blood on them. I'm going to tell them not to give you a cesarean. Like mom. You aren't gonna die. Like mom. They said that they take care of people who are 100% for nothing without paying anything, like in the hospital. They cure the wounded and the sick. And they bury the severed legs in the dead bodies. And they give the survivors something to eat. And it seems that the kids, they can go back to school afterwards. It's game over. But the game isn't over for us. We're going to restart the game. We're going to start a new game because it's over now. We'll live happily. And we will have many, many children.
So I'm Heather Denyer. I was honored to translate this play of Edouard Elvis Bouma coming to us from Cameroon. And before we started rehearsing the play, we asked Edouard a question that I think you'd all be interested in too, how he was inspired to write this story. Even though child soldiers are not a regular occurrence in Cameroon, there certainly are elsewhere in Africa.
Alors, j'avais dit ce dont on parlait hier à propos des enfants soldats en Afrique. Et puis, tes premières idées pour écrire la pièce.
Voilà, à propos des enfants soldats, je dois dire, j'aime toujours le rappeler que j'ai pas rencontré d'enfants soldats.
He hasn't met a child soldier himself.
Donc, mais je suis sensible à cette question parce que j'aime les enfants, j'ai été enfant. Et j'ai toujours voulu écrire une pièce qui traitait de ce sujet.
So, voilà. Because having been a child himself and liking children elsewhere, he really wanted to deal with this subject because he takes it very much to heart himself.
Voilà, et puis j'étais aussi passionné par la bande dessinée, le dessin et tout le reste. Donc, voilà, c'est tout ça qui m'amène vers cette écriture-là. Et puis avec tout ce qui se passe aujourd'hui, voilà, c'est un problème. Au moment où je commençais ce projet d'écriture, le Cameroun ne connaissait pas les attentats aujourd'hui où c'est des enfants qu'on envoie se faire exploser. Donc voilà, c'est des choses comme ça qui m'ont encore motivé à aller à fond dans ce projet.
So, having been inspired by cartoons himself, he was thinking about the realities of this, the possibility of child soldiers. When he first started writing this, he hadn't known, there hadn't been a lot of major issues going on in Cameroon, including suicide attacks that are now happening in the northern part of the country. And I can add that also the west part of the country is fighting to secede from the rest of the country at the moment. There's a lot of violence. And so putting these two ideas together really inspired him towards this. So I'd love to address some of the questions that you might have for Edward.
I was wondering. Hello. Thank you for being here and coming all this way to talk about this.
Yes, you definitely.
I was wondering, where was the choice made that the male character would be telling the story and talking to the woman versus maybe speaking just to the audience?
Donc elle a demandé pourquoi est-ce que tu as choisi avoir le personnage mâle parler à la fille et pas tout simplement au public.
Oui, parce que c'est déjà la forme dans laquelle j'ai décidé de présenter ça. Et aussi, parce que ça, c'est vraiment un double projet d'écriture. C'est d'écrire sur les enfants soldats, mais il y a aussi la question du viol que j'ai voulu faire ressortir. Et ce n'était pas le public qui me permettait d'aborder cette question, parce que les enfants embarqués, c'est des garçons et des filles, et ils sont excusés différemment. Donc, c'était par l'adresse à la jeune fille que la question du viol aussi pouvait ressortir.
So it's a double project that treats child soldiers and also rape of girls, because in war, both boys and girls are involved. And through this, he was trying to address both topics through the connection of one to the other.
Oui, j'ai écrit l'histoire de la fille et vraiment c'est très particulier parce que au départ justement c'est comme elle dit, j'ai donné la parole au garçon et je ne pensais même pas qu'il y aurait une suite. C'est après avoir écrit ce premier texte que je me suis rendu compte, voilà, que peut-être ce serait aussi intéressant que la fille ait une parole, et j'ai écrit donc l'histoire de la fille.
So when he first started out, he didn't think about the fact that he would be really interested, motivated to write the perspective of the girl, and then he did, and he wrote a second play that does address the perspective of the girl through the experience of war.
Merci. Thank you. Thank you very much for the work. I'm thinking about, of course, the premise of the boy understanding the world through comic books and through fantasy, but in particular, certain Hollywood fantasy and American Western hero fantasy. And I wonder if you could talk a little bit about that in your work, and does it exist in other parts of your work as well?
Ce n'est pas tout simplement des bandes dessinées, mais en fait, les personnages des westerns, des États-Unis, de Hollywood et tout ça, est-ce que ça a des influences dans des autres projets aussi?
Non, non, non. Ce projet, il est à part. Donc,
this is a separate project, so it doesn't necessarily influence this other work.
Ce que j'écris, ça n'a rien à voir. Déjà, l'histoire de la fille. L'histoire de la fille, il n'y a pas ces références au dessin
right.
animé.
They are not part of the other play that takes the perspective of the girl.
Where was it performed before? Où est-ce que la pièce a été jouée?
Alors, la pièce n'a pas encore été jouée. Donc, elle a beaucoup plus été lue.
So it hasn't been performed yet, it has been read. And I should add that it has received 2 prizes, which we probably should have said in the beginning. But yeah, I think really recently. C'est récemment qu'on vient de gagner le prix, non?
Non, la pièce a gagné le prix en 2016. Donc, voilà. Et donc, ça a été beaucoup, ça a été lu bon, en Afrique, au Cameroun, en Guinée-Conakry. Et ça a été beaucoup lu aussi en France. Ça a été lu au Festival d'Avignon. Et puis, en radio aussi, donc voilà, sur RFI et sur France Culture. Donc voilà, il y a eu pas mal de lectures quand même.
So it's been done on, as a radio play as well, via Radio France. It's also been read in Avignon, at their famous international festival. And it's been read in Cameroon, in Guinée-Conakry as well. And there was a question in the back.
Is it set in a specific country or a fictional country? And are the antagonists identified with specific groups or, again, fictional groups?
Est-ce que c'est basé dans la réalité ou bien c'est fictif?
C'est une histoire totalement imaginée, c'est-à-dire les personnages, le contexte, mais il y a de la réalité. Je me suis inspiré de ce qui se passe un peu partout, là où il y a eu ce genre de tragédie, où on a toujours 2 grands groupes, où on a une manipulation, donc on a eu des histoires comme ça au Rwanda, au Libéria, au Congo, j'en passe. Et on a des histoires comme ça au nord du Cameroun, aujourd'hui, enfin, dans la région où Boko Haram sévit, où des jeunes filles ont été enlevées, c'est ces filles qu'on envoie se faire exploser avec des ceintures. Donc voilà, je m'inspire de la réalité, mais c'est vraiment une histoire. C'est des noms d'ethnie qui n'existent pas. Il y a beaucoup d'imagination quand même, et partant de la réalité.
So it's completely his imagination. Kimbilili and the Mungaligali are the made-up ethnicities. Deacon Barry is the town mentioned that they've already taken. But it's fictive. However, of course, it's based in some sort of inspiration from the truth, from ethnic wars in Rwanda and Congo and Libya, but also recently in the northern part of Cameroon, the story of the girls being abducted by Boko Haram. Maiduguri, the town that's now infamous in Nigeria, where the girls were abducted from and then sent to blow themselves up in the marketplace, is a town that is right next to Cameroon. And so Cameroon has been directly affected by this too, and that's part of what's being reflected in this, in the play.
How long did it take you to write this work, and when it was performed in the other settings, was it performed in the total, like, long version of it?
So it hasn't been performed yet, and we actually did, we cut a little bit. It's quite a long play for one person. Elle a demandé combien de temps ça t'a pris pour écrire.
Alors, combien de temps ça m'a pris? Je vais dire, en général, j'écris longtemps, mais j'écris aussi très vite. Ça veut dire que avant d'entrer dans l'écriture réelle, pendant longtemps, j'écris la pièce dans ma tête. Ça peut être en marchant, en faisant, je ne sais pas, n'importe quoi. Ah. J'ai des petits bouts dont il y a beaucoup de... Je prends beaucoup de notes, mais là, je suis vraiment dans l'écriture. J'ai déjà des scènes toutes faites, mais quand je rentre dans l'écriture, ça va très vite. Ce qui fait que j'ai pensé la pièce pendant peut-être un an ou plus, mais j'ai écrit en moins d'un mois.
Writing process was about 3 weeks, but it was about 1 year when he was writing in his head, no matter what he was doing, a little bit thinking on it all the time, and then when he sat down to actually write it, it was about 3 weeks.
One last.
So, final question.
Hi, thank you for your play. My question is this. In the play, the boy killer mentions that he has cut many women's children out of the stomach. So this is something very rarely mentioned in war, because it happens to many women in war, and it's rarely a topic spoken about. What made you decide to include it in the play?
Donc, c'est à propos des faits que des césariennes et puis le jeu entre, because he doesn't himself understand the difference between his mother having a cesarean that went wrong and the actual act. Donc, le fait que les soldats souvent coupent le ventre des mamans pour prendre les bébés pendant les guerres. Qu'est-ce qui t'a amené à inclure cette réalité dans l'histoire?
Oui, j'ai inclus cette réalité justement parce que quand je me suis penché sur le sujet, quand j'ai fait des recherches ou en regardant des documentaires ou en lisant des études, des enquêtes qui sont faites.
In reading, seeing this in documentaries or reading about this reality in the newspaper and elsewhere.
Voilà. Donc, et ça justement, ça fait partie de ce dont la dame parlait, de la réalité. Est-ce que je m'inspire de la réalité? Donc, en regardant ou en lisant des études, je vois qu'il y a par exemple des situations de femmes, parce que le traitement en guerre, le traitement des jeunes filles est différent. Traitement accordé aux jeunes garçons.
Returning to the earlier question about how this is based in reality, he felt that there are so many of these realities for young girls in the wars that don't qui ne sont pas souvent adressées, c'est ça?
Oui, c'est pas souvent pareil, et c'est vraiment ça aussi qui m'a poussé à écrire une suite, parce que voilà, la guerre, le garçon lui se prend pour un héros, ils sont formés comme ça, alors que les filles ne sont même pas des soldats, c'est des esclaves, c'est un personnel, c'est des domestiques qui sont là, des esclaves sexuels ou qui préparent pour les chefs. Donc, et justement,
and that was really one of the things that pushed him to write the companion piece, because these boys, child soldiers, and any soldiers, male soldiers, they take themselves as heroes in a way. And then the girls are not even involved in the war. They're dragged in and they become sex slaves. And he wanted to give that a voice too. Dernièrement?
Oui, donc voilà, et c'est justement pourquoi avec les femmes, ils vont le plus loin possible. C'est-à-dire que c'est le viol, c'est lorsqu'elles sont enceintes, parce que la haine vraiment va au niveau extrême où, voilà,
They really have to are faced with the worst of all of this, with the rape and with murder like this. Yeah. It's sort of a heartbreaking play, I find, in the way that it uses humor to deal with these real issues. Thank you so much, Edouard, Elvis, Uma, for
thank
coming
you.
Here. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes. 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 Yes
Gracias.